गुड मॉर्निंग चिल्ड्रेन।
गुड मॉर्निंग मॉम।
वी डिस्कस्ड अबाउट मोनो हाइब्रिड क्रोस लास्ट क्लास। होप यू रिमेम्बर द डेफिनेशन आई गेव फॉर दैट। व्हाट इज मीन बाय मोनो हाइब्रिड क्रोस एविलिन?
अ क्रोस दैट इज मेड बिटवीन द वन पेयर ऑफ कंट्रास्टिंग कैरेक्टर।
A cross which involves one pair of contrasting characters is known as monohybrid cross. And in carrying out these cross hybridization experiments, what are the different steps that Mendel carried out? Gayatri?
He first selected two pea plants with contrasting characters. And then he did emasculation on them. And
then pollens were collected
and then rested on the pea plant.
From the male plant or male parent plant, pollen were collected and rested on
the female
stick of the female parent. Then next,
bagging was done.
And then they were allowed to form seeds, and these were collected and grown. Okay, now once again we will have a recap of this monohybrid cross because we are continuing the same thing. So whatever we learned about monohybrid cross, once again we'll see and we'll continue. So Mendel, he crossed tall and dwarf pea plants for studying the inheritance of one gene. So not only tall and dwarf character he selected, at a time he concentrated on one pair of characters and he tried out with other combinations also, concentrating at a time on one set of characters. He collected the seeds which are produced as a result of the cross and he grew them. So upon crossing tall and dwarf plants, you know, it will lead to fertilization resulting in the formation of seeds. These seeds were collected and upon raising the seeds, he found that in the first generation, so the generation raised from this or produced from these seeds, he called as first F1 generation or filial one generation or the first hybrid generation. And he found that all of them were tall. The tallness only was exhibited in the F1 plants. None of the plants were dwarf. All resembled one of the parents. Mendel observed that all the F1 progeny plants were tall, like one of its parents, and none were dwarf. So you know that two parents were involved, tall and dwarf. So all were like the tall parent, and no plants were dwarf. And he made similar observations when he tried out with other pair of traits. So you can generalize that in the F1 generation, only one of the parental characters were expressed, whether it is cross between tall and dwarf, violet and white, or whatever cross or whatever combinations he made when he concentrated on one character at a time. Or in monohybrid cross, in the first generation, only one of the parental characters were one of the parental characters was exhibited and that of the other parent was not at all seen. So he wanted to find out what has happened to the other character, and for that he self-pollinated. He didn't involve any other plant. The same plant, self-pollinate means to select the pollen from the same plant and dusting it on the stigma of the same plant. So the tall plants which he got by F1 generation, they were self-pollinated, and then he observed the results. So then he found that along with the tall plant, some dwarf plants were also produced in F2 generation. So from this we can make out that those both parental characters were present in the plants, but one was remaining hidden. Even though only one of the characters got expressed in the F1 generation, the other character had not disappeared. They were lying hidden. And in the F2 generation, both characters were expressed. And the proportion of the plants that were dwarf, The character which was remaining hidden in the F1 generation was a dwarf character, and this dwarf plants contributed 1/4 of the total F2 plants produced, while 3/4 of them, majority of them, were tall plants just like the F1 generation. Okay, and in F1 generation, the character, the only character which got expressed was found in 75% in the next generation too. The tall and dwarf characters were identical to their parental type. This also we had discussed. So the characters, the plants produced were either tall or dwarf. So in terms of height, they resembled one of their parents. They did not show, these characters did not show any blending. And the proof is that we couldn't find any medium height plants. That proves that there were no blending of tall and dwarf characters. And same he could find, or same he could observe when he tried out with other traits too. Only one of the parental traits got expressed in the F1 generation, and in the F2 generation, both characters got expressed in the ratio 3:1. Or you can say 3/4:1/4 or 75% to 25%. 3 were tall, 1 was dwarf. So here you can see with the help of a Punnett square, last year you have learned the monohybrid crows is shown over here. So parents, since you have a previous knowledge about it, since you had learned in 10th standard, I hope you will be able to follow it easily. So this is how we have written down the monohybrid crows. Parents, just a minute. Parents, as I told, he was crossing a tall plant and a dwarf plant. And I also told that he was crossing, or he crossed pure breeding lines, so true breeding lines. Means with respect to that character, they were having homozygous condition. Homozygous dominant tall. About dominance we didn't learn, we'll be learning. The character which got expressed in the F1 generation is said to be tall character. And the character, dominant character. And the character which remained hidden in the F1 generation, you call it as a recessive character. Once again, the character which got expressed in the F1 generation, you call it as dominant. And the one which remains hidden in presence of dominant characters, recessive. And tall is represented by a pair of capital T, and dwarfness is represented by a pair of small letter T. And hope you know, these represent, with the help of alphabets, we are representing the genes responsible for it. You know that in our body, all the characters are expressed by, are controlled by a pair of factors. Mendel called them as factors. He was not knowing the term genes, or he, at that time, he was unaware of genes. So he called these as factors. So each character is controlled by a pair of factors. We too have, take the case of any character, we have a pair of factors or a pair of genes, one that we get from father and one that we get from mother. And they get separated. Only these genes will be in the unpaired condition, only in the gametes. In individuals, in all the other body cells, we will have a pair of genes governing each character. So the parents, the individuals, or these plants, are shown as tall and dwarf. The character is represented, or the genes are represented using a pair of capital T and a pair of small letter T. So here, even though you know about it, we used alphabet T. Why did we use the alphabet T? Usually, for representing the genes, we select the first letter of the dominant character. So tall, you know, tall is the dominant character because only tallness was expressed in the F1 generation. Dwarf was hidden. So that is the hidden character is recessive. So the first letter of the dominant character is used for expressing the genes. And capital T is used for the dominant character, and its small letter case is used for the recessive character. We should not use, you have to be careful, you should not use capital T for tallness and small letter D for dwarfness. So that is wrong. We should use two versions of the same alphabet. I've seen some of them, they write, they write small letter. Capital letter they use for representing the tall or the dominant character, and small letter for the recessive character. But the alphabets, they might change. Capital T for tallness and small letter D for dwarfness, that should not be used. The same alphabet, different cases should be used. And which alphabet we are selecting? The first letter of the dominant character is the alphabet usually selected, and it's two different cases, uppercase for a dominant character and lowercase for expressing recessive character. Children, if you come across any doubts, you may stop me in between. Okay, so now you understood the first line, I think. The first one, I think you have understood. This line, I hope you understood. He selected two parents, tall and dwarf. Okay, here it is written homozygous. Dominant, you can simply write tall and dwarf, no problem. Here, why homozygous and dominant? I explained. Mendel selected true breeding plants for carrying out these crosses. So, true breeding means they'll be having the genes in the homozygous condition, no mixing of genes. Same type will be present, the genes will be identical. So, capital T, small letter T, as we already learned in 10th standard and the previous slides, that only tallness is getting expressed in the F1 generation and dwarfness is not getting expressed. You know that tall is the dominant character and dwarf is a recessive character. And regarding the letters also, I told on what basis we are choosing. You should not use your small letter T, that is wrong. You should use the different cases of the same alphabet. Now, gametes, next sentence or next step is to write the gametes. And I told you that in an organism, the genes will be in the paired condition. But when they form gametes, the genes will be in unpaired condition. Representing each character, only one gene will be present in the gamete. But in an organism, two genes will be representing each character. I think you have no confusion, because in gametes, you know, chromosomes or the genes are in unpaired condition. So gene gamete is represented by capital T, because only one type of gametes can be formed. Possibility is only one type of gamete. All gametes will be having capital T for tallness, whereas the gamete formed by the dwarf parent is small letter T. No other options. Now, the first generation, he crossed it. You know how the crossing is done. Emasculation, bagging, then again dusting the pollen, all that you know, and collecting the seeds and raising. And he found all the plants produced was tall. So this was not known in the beginning. Now, even though they have mentioned it, when Mendel was carrying out the experiments, he was not knowing whether it is heterozygous or homozygous. Since we know from the results, it is being written like that. What he found, so this we will avoid for now. What he found was all the plants were tall externally. He was not checking the genes. He was not able to do that, because at that time when he raised these F1 plants, so collecting the seeds produced and raised the plants, and he found externally all were tall. Externally all plants were tall. So he thought dwarfness might have got disappeared. But the genetic condition was this T and this T combined, and we got capital T, small letter T. Okay. And in such a condition, you can call it heterozygous, because the two genes are different. Capital T, small letter T. And in spite of having this condition, all the plants were tall. That indicates that tallness is the dominant character and dwarfness is the recessive character, because tall character was hiding, suppressing the other character. So when they come in heterozygous condition, only dominant character will get expressed. If the recessive character should get expressed, they should be in the homozygous condition. In heterozygous condition, the recessive character gets never expressed. Now then, as I told you, he tried out selfing, self-pollination, without involving any other parent. He wants to know whether these two characters are remaining hidden or it has got disappeared. For that only he did selfing. He did not include any other plant. So same he self. That means the pollen from the same is dusted on the stigma of the same. So TT into TT, same plant. So here two gametes can be formed. Here only one letter was there, one gene was there. So only one possibility. Here two types of gametes. Male, as the male part also produced two types of gametes. Now with the help of a Punnett square, this is a checkerboard which you call it Punnett square, and it was introduced or proposed by Reginald. Okay, Reginald Punnett, and he suggested this method to finding out the probability of the offsprings produced as a result of these crosses. And by selfing F1 generation, he raised the F2 generation. So how it is done is, we write the gametes on the left side and on the top side. On the top and on the left side, we write the gametes and we make boxes like this. Okay, so we make boxes in this way, and one can be considered as the male parent, these gametes as that of the female parent. And you know, when these two are crossed, or when these two combine, okay, different possibilities are there. Four possibilities are there. When these two combine, it will be TT, definitely tall. When this and this combines, you will get TT, it is heterozygous tall. And when this and this, you have to join the one on the top and one on the left end. So what you get is TT, heterozygous tall, but still, even though it is in the heterozygous condition, externally it is tall, and only one was dwarf when it got expressed in the homozygous condition. And children, hope you know the difference between phenotype and genotype. So the external expression, that is when you write tall, that is the phenotype. Physically what you see, externally what you see, dwarf. Or when you say violet, white, all those are phenotypes. But when you say TT or small letter TT, that is known as the genotype. So genotype is the genetic arrangement and phenotype is the physical expression. Phenotype means the physical expression and genotype is a genetic arrangement. Any doubt in this? Any doubt?
No, ma'am.
This already I've learned, but some new students are also there. So, and children, the contrasting traits did not show any blending, whether it is F1 or F2 generation. We couldn't find any blending of characters. I already told you, we couldn't find any medium height plants. So Mendel proposed that something was stably passed down, unchanged from the parent to the offspring, through the gametes, generation after generation. So from this, Mendel understood that something is there which is getting passed on from the parent to the offsprings unchanged and regularly. So whenever reproduction is taking place, these genes are being transferred through the gametes, generation after generation. And he called these things as factors. He named it as factors, and later these were called as genes. So Mendel named them as factors, and he told that a pair of factors decide each characters in organisms. Genes are the units of inheritance. So here I've shown this picture just to make you understand the connection between nucleus, chromosome, DNA, gene. You know, inside the cell, nucleus is there. And inside the nucleus, if you take our case, we have 23 pairs of 46 chromosomes within the cell. Except in gametes, all other cells have paired chromosome. And chromosomes are made up of, see here you can see, the chromosome is unwound and shown. So here, when it is unwound, you can see DNA. Chromosomes are made up of DNA and proteins. And what is gene? A segment of DNA is known as gene, which controls the expression of characters. So once again, the contrasting characters did not show any blending, whether in the F1 or F2 generation, either in the F1 or F2 generation, no blending was shown. And from this, based on his experiments, he suggested that something is being stably passed down from the parents to the offsprings through gametes, unchanged generation after generation. And he called them as factors. And these factors are known as genes today. Genes are the units of inheritance. They are responsible for transmitting the hereditary characters from parents to the offsprings. Genes which code for a pair of contrasting traits are known as alleles. They are slightly different forms of the same gene. So gene which code for a pair of contrasting characters. See, I'll give you an example. Capital T, small letter T. Both representing same character. That means height. Slightly different. One is dwarf and the other one is tall. Gene for tall and gene for dwarf. So these are coding for a pair of contrasting characters. So these two you can call as alleles, or you can say alternatives of the same gene. Alternatives of the same gene, or two different versions of the same gene, you can call as alleles. Different forms of the same gene. Genes which code for a pair of contrasting characters are known as alleles. Capital T and small letter T are alleles. When these alleles are identical, it's homozygous condition. When these alleles are non-identical, heterozygous condition. Okay? The contrasting characters do not show any blending, neither in the F1 or F2 generation, no blending is shown. And Mendel, based on his studies, he realized that, or he proposed that some factors are being passed on from the parents to the children or to the offsprings through gametes, unchanged and being passed on stably. These are known as genes today. Genes are the units of inheritance, and slightly different forms of the same gene is known as alleles. Or genes which code for a pair of contrasting characters are known as alleles. So here, just to make it clear, to make you understand the concept, you know that, just imagine these are two chromosomes, one from father and one from mother. From mother, father. Okay, so two chromosomes. We have 23 pairs. 23 come from father, 23 from father. Okay, father and mother, 23 each, and that together make 46. You know that chromosomes are in the paired condition. Now just see a single pair of chromosome. Two chromosomes, a single pair of chromosome is shown here to make you understand. So this is how one is from father, one is from mother. Now you can see some specific regions where the genes are present. Okay, take the case of this one. And here father's gene is R, mother's gene is also R. So that will be, that character is in the homo, the genes are in the homozygous condition. So the character representing R will get expressed. And another, governing another character, PP. This is dominant from the alphabet, you know. So that character will get expressed. But here, here few more examples are shown. This is homozygous dominant. Father and mother both are having the gene in the homozygous condition. Definitely that character will get expressed. Here it is in the recessive condition. Still this character will be expressed because both of them are having the same. Whereas in this, it is in the heterozygous condition. Tell me whose character. Let it be any character. they have not just a few examples they have given. They have not mentioned which character, but just to make you understand. Now, capital C and small letter C. Tell me in that case, whose character will get expressed? Father's or mother's?
Mother's.
Mother's character will get expressed in the child. So this is how the governance or the characters get expressed. Okay. Out of that pair of characters, if it is homozygous dominant or homozygous recessive, you know that character will be expressed. Father and mother are having identical genes. But when it is in the heterozygous condition, whether it is father or mother, whoever is having the gene in the homozygous condition, their character will get expressed. Got it? This diagram you don't have to learn, but just to get an idea how this works. So here again, already the points what I've told you. Capital letters are used for the trait which is getting expressed at the F1 generation, and small letters or small alphabets are used for the other trait that will remain hidden. So the dominant character is getting or is expressed using capitals and recessive character using small letter. T is used for tall and small letter T is used for dwarf. And I told you, when you choose the alphabet for expressing the genes, we take the first alphabet of the dominant character. Do not use T for tall and D for dwarf, because then you will not be able to make out whether T and D are alleles of the same gene. So we say that these two alternative versions are alleles of the same gene. That's why we are using the same alphabet. If you use two different alphabets, that can be very confusing. T and T are alleles. I told you these are the two slightly different forms of the same gene. Hence in plants, the pair of alleles for height, three pairs of alleles are there. Either it can be TT, homozygous dominant, a pair of capital T, a pair of small letter T, or capital T and small letter T. So these are the three possible pairs of alleles in terms of height in plants. So here again, the same thing I've shown, parents, gametes, then self cross-fertilization and raising the F1 generation, TT, and all these will be tall, then Mendel carried out selfing, and then using a Punnett square, he carried it out, and you know this will be tall, even though in heterozygous condition, this also will be tall, as tallness is dominant, tall. And this will be dwarf. So that is 3:1. Okay. Now 3:1. It is not that just four plants were produced, just to make you understand the ratio or how out of four, every one was, one of them will be tall. For every four plants, one will be dwarf and three will be tall. And phenotypic and genotypic ratio. What is the difference between genotypic and phenotypic ratio, children? What is the difference between phenotypic and genotypic ratio? Phenotypic ratio is just based on the external appearance. See, take the case of this plant. So externally what he found was, so he found three tall, one dwarf. Externally, that is what we find. I told phenotype is a physical expression. Externally, what we see. So three tall. When he noticed, he could see 3, 1, 2, 3. And for every three tall, one dwarf plant. But if, when you check the genotypes, in terms of the genetic arrangement, you can see, see, this forms first category, that is a pair of capital T, homozygous tall, just one. And you can see two heterozygous tall. And this is homozygous dwarf. So 1:2:1 is the genotypic ratio. phenotypic ratio is based on only the external appearance. Externally, whoever is observing it, they just see three tall, one dwarf. So that is phenotypic ratio. But if you analyze the genes, then you will find genes are found. Genes for tallness are found in the homozygous condition as well as in the heterozygous condition. And genes for dwarfness were found in the homozygous condition. So one homozygous tall, you can even write like this. One TT is to two TT is to one TT. One homozygous tall, two heterozygous tall, and one homozygous dwarf. I hope you know what is the difference between homozygous, homo, similar, hetero, different. In homozygous, both genes, both alleles will be identical, and in heterozygous, the alleles in a gene pair will not be identical. Even if a single T is present in the genotype, phenotype will be tall. When both are present together, you know, capital T will be dominating and it will be suppressing the expression of small letter t. So when in the heterozygous condition, capital T will suppress the expression of small letter t. So we call it is, we call capital T as the dominant trait and small letter T is a recessive trait. So dominant character is the one which gets expressed in the F1 generation and suppresses the expression of the recessive character. And at the same time, the dominant character will contribute 3/4 of the F2 generation also. In a true breeding tall or dwarf pea plant variety, the allelic pair of genes for height are identical or homozygous, capital T, capital T, small letter T, small letter. I told for true breeding, they will be in the homozygous condition. True breeding dwarf, it will be in the homozygous condition. So when you say true breeding plant, they will have homozygous condition with respect to that particular gene. TT plant is heterozygous for genes controlling height, that you know. Capital T, small letter T is the heterozygous condition that we get by crossbreeding, pure breeding, tall and dwarf, the F1 generation. F1 generation consists of heterozygous tall plants externally being the heterozygous condition and capital T being dominant, all were tall. TT, TT means capital T. Capital T, capital T, small letter T, small letter T, small letter T, these all are genotypes. And the descriptive terms, tall and dwarf, you call them as phenotypes. And from the cross, we can find that alleles of the parental pair separate or segregate from each other, and only one allele gets transmitted to the gamete. Okay. So I'll repeat what I told. The last two points. See, we can see that the alleles, take the case of this one. Alleles at the time of gamete formation, you can see they are getting separated. Each gamete will have only one allele. So from an individual or from the plant having both the alleles at the time of gamete formation, what is happening? They are getting separated and only one will enter each gamete. You cannot write both these together in the gametes. At the time of gamete formation, alleles will separate or segregate and only one will be entering each gamete. So that means there is 50-50 possibility of having either allele. See here, you can find capital T, small letter T. Okay. And when they form gametes, 50% possibility for capital T and 50% possibility for small letter T. Clear? You want a quick recap of what we learned today?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, after that, more are there. I thought it will be, otherwise it will be lengthy if I don't stop here. And then you should answer my questions. So we started with Mendel-Kroll, Stahl, and I'll just quickly read it. Mendel-Kroll, Stahl, and dwarf pea plants to study the inheritance of a single gene. And he collected these seeds and raised the first generation. He found all the plants were tall and none of them were dwarf. And the same observations he made with other combinations, or when he tried out with other traits also, he found or he got the same result. F1 always resembled, F1 hybrids always resembled one of their parents, and the other character, the character of the other parent was lying hidden, and Mendel then self-pollinated these plants, and to his surprise he found that in the F2 generation, both plants were found in 3:1 ratio, or 75% to 25%. In that percentage, or in terms of fraction, you can say 3/4 of them were tall and 1/4 were dwarf. And another point that we learned is these characters did not blend. They were either tall or dwarf, and we did not get, or he did not observe any intermediate plants with intermediate height. And you know, genes are the unit of inheritance, and genes are segment, functional segments of DNA, and genes which code for a pair of contrasting characters you call as alleles. They are slightly different forms of the same gene. And in terms of the letter use, we always use the first letter of the dominant character in capital form to represent the dominant character, and same alphabets, small letter case, for expressing the recessive character. Capital T is used to represent tall and small letter T for dwarf. And never use two different alphabets for representing the two different versions of the same character. Capital T and small letter T are alleles of each other. Deciding height, there are three pairs of alleles, homozygous T, heterozygous small letter T, homozygous dominant tall, then homozygous recessive dwarf, and heterozygous tall, or heterozygous tall condition also you can find. And for the dominant character to get expressed, one gene is enough. That is why a pair of capital T and one capital T and a small letter T remains tall. So even if one gene representing the dominant character is present, only that will get expressed. And when both these are together, when capital T and small letter T come together, the capital T, the dominant gene, will suppress the expression of the recessive character. In a true breeding, tall or dwarf plant, the allelic pair for height will be identical. So I told that when you say true breeding, tall and dwarf, they will have similar genes, similar alleles. Alleles will be identical. Okay, true breeding plants, they will have the genes responsible for that character in the homozygous condition. And homozygous and heterozygous condition, I know the difference. So genotypes means a genetic arrangement, and phenotype means a physical expression. And you know that at the time of gamete formation, these alleles will get separated, and only one of the genes will enter the gamete. The gamete will receive only one of the gene representing the character. I'll repeat again, at the time of gamete formation, the genes in pair will get separated and only one will enter each gamete. So we'll continue next period. So first we will have a review and then we'll continue with the topic. Okay, now we don't have time to ask the questions. So thank you, children. If you have any doubts, beginning of the next session, you can clarify it. Okay, Michael? Thank you.